I think about starting tomorrow that God will open from our dynamic perspective. But before that, allow me to briefly introduce myself. So I'll introduce myself and then bring you to the world of global models. And I'll explain a little bit about one particular model, that is EcoOcean, which is the model that we have been developing here. Some of the improvements of EcoOcean, and I'm going to show you some of the new results that are basically out of the oven this week. And finally, some concluding remarks. So as Billy said, I'm coming from the Institute of Marine Science in Barcelona. It is the largest marine institute in Spain and one of the largest in the southern of Europe. So basically, we develop quite a lot of interdisciplinary research, basically centering these three overlapping challenges that you see there. And my lab in particular develops integrated analysis of ecosystems from local to regional areas, especially in the Mediterranean, but we also work in the South Atlantic, in the Arctic, and we create collaborations with several labs. We also do quite a lot of toxic ecology research, really looking at what the species eat and what also the predators or species at risk, so all this kind of local laboratory work. But today I'm going to be talking about very, very different stuff. Here is my lab in 2019. I'm glad to that I'm able to have the students and the professors and also my sisters and undergrads of your big crowd. And just for you as a reference, in Europe we have different sources of funding. So we obviously have the funding that comes from the national government, but we also get quite a lot of funding from the European Commission, and that really allows us to do interdisciplinary and transnational work. So these are the projects that we have right now. Some of the projects are at the European level, and then there is a project with Norway and the Arctic, and several collaborations with Canada. That's why I keep on coming here, and especially I collaborate a lot with the Christensen Lab and groups. I also want to point out, before getting into the knowledge, that in ECM, especially in my lab, we have been promoting this creation of what is called Barcelona Ocean, which is a platform for teaching specialized courses. And we bring, we try to give continuity to some of these courses. So we teach ecosystem modeling every year and programming. But we also try to bring researchers and colleagues from all over the world to teach with us, so that benefits our students, but also benefits the colleagues who want to spend some time with us in Barcelona. And these are some of the colleagues that have been teaching with us over the last year. So I would like to open the invitation and invite you all to come either as students or if you consider to come as teachers and stay with us for a little bit there. Okay, and now the topic of the presentation. I'm going to talk about ecological models of the global ocean, and I think it's quite obvious why they are important, so why this view of the ocean is important as well, as much as looking at the regional and the local scale of human impact besides health care, and also climate change to main impact, which really has an impact everywhere and with impacts around the globe, and to the impact also on biodiversity. So that has been a large effort by scientific community from some time ago now, trying to model the dynamics of the global ocean. And we all have in mind the things that IPCC has been doing, great job with a large community of modelers trying to understand what's happening, especially at the lower traffic level, so the mechanical or primary production level. But there is also, this figure in particular is very interesting. This is a summary figure that comes from the last IPCC report. But just to summarize nicely how this large community of modelers are trying to come together and to give us a representation of what is happening. So in the first line, you have the output of some of these, we could say, Earth system models or oceanic models trying to give us information on what's happening to the primary production and to the conditions, physical conditions of the ocean, to project the conditions. Over there, you have two scenarios, what we call the most optimistic scenarios, or 2.6 RCP, or the most optimistic one, the 8.5. And you can see how different these projections are if we are under one scenario or the other. The second column gives you, okay, what would be the impact of those projections in the biomass of animals in what is it? So from climate production up. And over there, this is a summary information that is already consumed by active city, by feedback, and it's very important what the Risk Modeling Community is doing there, because it's really informing policy right now. So, okay, there's several models out there that try to get around this challenge of modeling the population. There's the size risk models, the species distribution models, composite models, or imprint models that, try to bridge different hypotheses. And because of this increasing computer power, big data, and also the modularity of this eco-positive ecosystem approach that we heard here at the lab last week, we understand the data presentation. So we decided to go global as well and try to create this microdynamic global model of the ocean. So the ocean of recording was born, and officially was published as the first paper since 2015. And Billy Christensen is the lead author of that paper. I'm sure you will be able to answer questions about global ocean dynamics here. And basically, this is the model that I'm going to be showing you, and I'm going to show what are the improvements to this. But let me introduce as well this initiative. This is the FISHNET initiative. And for the ones that you have not heard about it, it's basically a first intent by the community of global modelers to work together and to compare what our results were giving us. So it's a modeling that provides a project to better understand and forecast the long-term impact of climate change on the oceans and our fisheries. So FISHNET has brought this large community of marine ecosystem modelers, so I'm going to be referring to maybe them. And in here, there have been several models that have come together. So you have global models, some of them you may know, some of them you don't, and regional models. And we have all worked together. So FISHNET gave us a set of standardized inputs for our models, so drivers of climate reduction will change, or temperature will change. And we brought it, ran with our ecological models to project what will be the impact in the ocean for animals and for the living in general. And I'm mentioning that because it also was part of this model, and I'm going to show you some of the results later. I would like to add that this was really a great learning experience because modelers tend to work in parallel, and it's really nice to learn from each other and to see what other types of modeling are doing. That was, it has been a very interesting process that is still going on, and we are in Facebook. Okay, so what is EcoOcean? I'm going to introduce the original EcoOcean model for you. This is basically a try a prophodynamic based model in context, but run to the global level. Okay? And the aim for this model was to evaluate management actions impact of people within an ecosystem based context. So try to understand what's happening from bacteria all the way to whales and seabirds, including the fisheries. So some specificities of this model. And so this is a special kind of model that runs 1 degree or 0.5 degrees. It is a 2D, so it means that the water column is only indirectly taken into account, and by default runs in monthly time steps. So this one now has one functional group. The functional group is the way that we cluster or reorganize species, because we know that the ocean has thousands of species, so we try to organize them in groups that have similarities in terms of ecology, place of inheritance. And these functional groups are linked in a food web. And there's things like bacteria, plants, invertebrates, all the way up to the brain. And includes fishing as well, as I said, based on fishing as well. Each functional group has many different species. And then the model, as it was in 2015, was parametrized to represent the 1950s of the ocean. It was validated to global climate statistics at that time that were available. And then the EcoSpace EWE model is at the core of the computational model that we do. You heard a lot already about EcoPath and EcoSpin last week in the presentation of the room. I'm just going to briefly mention what it is and explain the three main components, because you later are going to be hearing especially about EcoSpin. So the main components of EcoPath. There's three. The EcoPath, which is the mass balance, the initialized component, that gives you a structure of the food web and the flow, how the species are connected, and also it tells the balance between what is produced in the system and what is consumed. the logical theory says that we cannot consume more than what we have in the system without consuming a consumption. So there has to be a balance there. After that, we go into the dynamic, temporal dynamic or spatial temporal dynamic. The dynamic model, what basically does, it simulates evolution effects of changes in mortality, social mortality, evolution mortality, and the changes in the environment. So how the functional groups in the flows changes because of changes in mortality and environment. And then, because they state that, basically, those dynamics in a 3D environment, in a spatial domain, and here for the base here map of climate distribution in the Western Mediterranean, is one of the models to work. Okay? Another thing that you heard last week, which is very important in all this topic of the global model, is the benefits from this new EWU modularity. You didn't spend in this time that how this EWU has drawn down, has been able to work with other models and data. So it's able to include some data from outside and also provide data that is useful for other models and for other analysis. And there's basically two main components of this new modularity that I want to mention today that we're also introducing. One is the spatial temporal framework, which really allows us to bring any type of data into the model and also split any type of data. So here, for example, you can bring in dynamic areas from materials. What this means that we can get maps, temporal spatial maps of primary production change in the ocean, and bring it into our model and see what is the impact of these changes in the ocean in our food web and in our biomasses and growth and construction of our organisms. So that has opened big possibilities for us. The second one is the habitat capacity, that I was also introduced last week. And it's basically a model, so we have got a niche model inside the football model. So it's really unifying the capability of analyzing football interaction and also the thing within a niche context. So basically, we set forth the suitability of its cell, in this case, we're in the context of a spatial temporal model. So we set the suitability of its cell for each species, for each time scale, and then the food web and the spatial interaction people. Okay? All this is published in papers, so if you have questions, please refer to the papers and obviously come to us for further questions, but this is quite well explained for the publication. Okay, so this is the structure of the global model as it was in 2015. And what I would like you from here just to understand that three main phases of the model is the static part where we parameterize initial conditions. And here you can see that the model borrowed quite a lot of data or linked to different models, databases to calculate the parameter that we need at the beginning. There is a temporal part of the model where we treated the model to continuous, and we also use some of the strong reduction analysis to calculate from the initial conditions, or the ones that you do at assessment may have the familiarity with the concept, but don't worry, this is also explained in the paper in 2015. And then we go into the spatial temporal domain of the model. And here is where several components link to the food web, which the food web component and the niche model. And here you can see that there's data coming in from Earth system models for primary production and temporary changes. Here there's data and connections to models that give information about fishing effort. And there is an internal model and then distributed fishing effort, a variety model. And then we have connections with global databases like ECOMAS, FISHDATE, that give us information about the preference functions and allows us to parameterize the habitat capacity. I leave it at this, but so this is for you to have a global idea on how complex these things can be, but also how modularity plays a big role here, because you can switch things on and off. So you can decide to switch some of the models of this model and then try to assess what's happening. And also the data is going to be relevant for this presentation. So it also, the spatial domain includes depth, so it's a layer that goes into the models. So we are trying to understand what's happening in the world, so there is a low depth profile. It includes private time and concentrations for the historical and for data. do what you're doing much better than us, from Earth to Mars, survive this. We have temperature layers, surface, that's in the lake, and you can include many, many types of different temperature layers. And it's part of assisting us also for two things. And these two things are the brilliant ionic and the alicinated layer, gravity layer. So some of the results of the collection are already published in the 2016 papers. And basically, this is okay. The first thing is that this model, because this model has this, and this other model, so the similar results or correct, more or less similar results to robots using cancer. So that's part of the validation of our model here. We also looked in those cancers where the large groups, proportionally, were similar between the observed and the predicted, and they were doing a reasonable job. And also by LMA. In this case, you can see that in some LMAs, we do better than in others. And also, from the model, you can start looking at the long-term trend, the projected trend of biomass and the type of indicators. In this case, you have the biomass of the small fish, medium fish, and large fish. Okay. And here I'm going to bring you back to this in a second, because it also was one of the models that we used to participate in the initial phase or the first phase of fishing. What we did in fishing was actually they gave us data to drive our models, and what they gave us is data from two Earth system models about the different one is TLBM, the other is ETFL, and four different RCP scenarios. Okay? So scenarios are representative concentration times, so how things can go in this region. And here you can see some of the data. So you can visualize some of the data that goes into this our model here. Here you have changes in temperature and changes in the production that are forecast by the Earth system models and that we are going to go through. You can see here how the change, how these models project changes in the historical period, and then how they project these changes in the future. For temperature, for climate production, with the two models, so two Earth system models, and with the two RCPs. So the optimistic and the pessimistic. So if you would be in an optimistic role, you would be, so the concentrations of carbon and we are able to mitigate and reduce our efficiency would be over here. And if we are not going to do anything about it and things go as they are, we are probably going to be. You can see how different the conditions in the ocean for temperature for climate production are projected to change. And this is given to us. And a series of global models, including the ocean, run these analysis. I love this figure here because I find it particularly informative. It summarizes all the maps I've seen before in time series. So you can see for the two Earth system models, for these three parameters, temperature, methane production, and carbon climate concentration, what is projected to come to this level? You can see that they are different the RCPs. So from a very optimistic to pessimistic. You can see that already the Earth system models project human growth in different, quite different things. So we got to start by thinking, okay, it will depend quite a lot when we get in our system models if human growth has a big brain. And then we went to the home and struggled for a while with all this massive data, so there are gigas and gigas of data. And then ran our models, and we were also asked to standardize our results. And this is really difficult for a model point of view, because we all have results that we all are very dedicated to. So this is a process of getting all our results and standardize them in indicators that all the models have produced. Levels of power. But then, with these indicators that were standardized, we could all compare our results. Okay, so this is a table of indicators that all the models participating in produce. This is an example of eco-ocean, and one of the indicators is the total consumer biomass, so the total biomass of animals in the ocean. And this is what eco-ocean was producing under the two Earth system models that I was showing you. TLBM and ETFL. You can see already that there's quite a lot of difference. Just bringing basis. And while the young seems to be much less, produce much less sensitive results, produces or business projects, future changes, like a lot of future changes. And then you have the representation of this, two, the most optimistic and the pessimistic, special representation of the two models and the two scenarios for the same indicators. You can see what kind of data we are dealing with. And again, the CCD, one of the papers that came out this year from CCD, and you have here, details on it all is the protocol that we all follow, which is like, if you're interested in this thing, it's like interesting thing to read because you can understand all the models and specificity. And in lots of all is where all these indicators, all the results are well put together, and things like that were presented. This is a global example projection of how the biomass in the ocean may change in the future, and the key scenario about the different scenarios of the emissions and using different models. And I would like to show you especially this projection here. This is the projections of different models, and you have the ocean there. GLDL and FSL, so the two existing models, and under the most pessimistic. What is interesting is the evolution under the most pessimistic doesn't seem to be projecting that much. And the scenario is that the model that was buffering the most, the impact, while using the GLDL, where it was kind of in the middle with some other models. So this is to try to understand that we have uncertainty that comes from system models, but we also have uncertainty in the different functions that we have in our ecological models. And that is why it's so important to do these ensemble projections and to do these comparisons together. Okay, so we in 2018, we were at this point and then we said, okay, we want to do better with our ecological model. We learned a lot and now we want to improve it. So what we did is we we are still doing, so this is where things are out of the oven, basically, and it's still waiting for others. So what we do is we improve the representation of the species contribution, so we wanted our functional groups to be representing more the biodiversity of the ocean, so we added corals, we added plants, several things, and we are still improving that. We improve responsive drivers, and I'm going to show you how, especially to temperature, and we are very interested in testing modularity of internal assumptions of our model. I'm going to show you a little bit. So why did we turn on and off things in that structure I was showing you before? And as much as the uncertainty in the drivers. So what is the importance of these drivers that come in and produce slightly or moderately different results of how climate adaptation is going to be the temperature? So to go a little bit more specific. For the improvement in different species contribution, we basically added more species on the functional groups. And we are now around 1,000 species, and this process may continue to improve many more if we are able to do that. For the improvement response to drivers, we have created or we have added two additional models in our calculus. One is the temperature adjusted metabolic rate to modify growth and temperature. And I'm going to explain very briefly how it works. And the other one is to initialize the distributions to neighborhoods. So we start running our model, we initialize where things should be because of the historical information that we have where things are in the ocean. Then we added more information about the environmental responses, and we have updated this, what it went in terms of system effort. And we are working in a model that will bring in some management, although so this is the new structure of the model as it is right now. Don't get afraid. We basically have been improving a lot the model from the spectral temporal representation of things by adding, so by updating several components of the model, but also by adding new things. The new things being the native ranges, what we call the T10, and I'll explain you why, and the NPS. And I'm now going to show you just three advances, one is the environmental difference functions and native ranges for the future. Hopefully, a paper in the near future will explain all of this. Okay, so for environmental difference functions, you heard a little bit about this as well, how we now bring in these environmental responses. We have some in the parish teachers comment that they are obligated to represent the function of the functional composition of the students. Here for you to understand, so you have, this is an histogram where you have the values of the driver, in this case it's temperature, so this is a number of temperature, and you have here, obviously there's quite a lot of zeros in the Arctic and Antarctic areas, and the poles, and the Arctic, so this is here, and then this kind of uniform, here is two uniform distributions on the rate of temperature, and here this will be the response of a specific functional group to this temperature profile. And this goes into the mixed model that we have implemented inside. The enable branches, how they work. Okay, so basically what we have done is at the start of each simulation, we put our functional group distributions to observe native ranges of the species. So where species have been appeared, so we integrate it and we produce these native ranges. Within native ranges, then the functional group can move around, okay, due to according to social abilities for the habitat capacity model picture. After the first run, the native ranges are released. And then, basically, the functional groups can move around if the environmental conditions and the natural conditions are okay. So we are sticking them at the beginning to tell them, we know you are here, historically, and now go and find your best place in the world. This is kind of the period. And technically, how it comes here is as an input capacity to the habitat capacity model. If you have curiosity, you can read this paper here and explain a little bit how. You can ask me questions. Okay, and the second movement has been this temperature adjusted metabolic rate. Because we know the metabolic rate of the species vary from optimal temperature conditions. So the activity, the growth, the reproduction species are temperature dependent. We don't care that much about this when we are modeling local or regional areas just because the ranges of temperatures don't change so much. But you can expect that when you're trying to model the global ocean, then that is what matters, right? Because the temperature that we find that still really cover a range of bodies. So we have done is we have borrowed this concept of the coefficient, which is basically a coefficient. It's a factor in which the metabolic rate is changes in every 10 degrees of change in temperature. So we have borrowed this concept and we have applied it to change the initial conditions of our growth and our consumption. So the species that are in the northern area, they would grow slowly and consume slowly, while the species that are in the tropics, their metabolic rate is faster, they grow faster and they consume faster. This is the assumption that we are adding to our model. And we are also exploring the possibility to not to use one factor, but to use different factor by species types. So now we implemented one for fish and one for invertebrates. And see if that makes a difference or not in our vision. Okay, now that it's learning, I think it's interesting. I'm going to show you some of the results of this experiment. And I'm really taking this as an experiment. So you have this modeling complex where you can turn things on and off, and now you're going to play. Okay, why did we climate change stick to? Why did climate and species stick to? What are the impacts of that? Or what are the impacts on this if we switch on and off things that we consider important in our model structure? So, native ranges or the QPR, how things respond to temperature. Is that making a difference in global understanding of the situation or not? So, these are the kind of questions that we are now trying to. So, if you are in an ocean without fishing, so imagine for a moment that there's no fishing in the ocean, and climate kicks in, what would be the impact of that? For that, we have, now that I'm showing you, the same indicators that FishNet was using. So, here you have the total system biomass, and here you have the total consumer biomass. Okay. And these are the responses of the trend, the time series of two Earth system models for GRBM and GPSR. So the one that we were showing before, and also two RCPS scenarios, the optimistic and the pessimistic. Okay. So as you can see, climate has an active effect. So also, and here we are only showing results for 2050, while in FishNet we were seeing all the way to 2100. instead of being expected to continue to decline. Yet now to this text number, IPFL and RCP 8%. So this is not a surprise. Our model is still produces these results, which are in tune with the rest of the results of the other global models. Okay, so we are okay. We don't need a special list, and we are continuing within the range of it's also interesting to see that the cases, the clients are there, they're small, but we are talking about big things. The whole biomass of animals in the ocean, so it's not small thing, it's a big thing. Okay, where is this change happening? So we start having these results, and you have, again, the total consumer biomass, the two models, the two RCP scenarios, and you see how the things are projected to be a little bit different in the theory. Bear in mind that we are only changing the drivers of climate. So we're not changing fishing, and we are not changing the internal population of the model. So that's the driver. And these are, if you would weight all the results in your view. Okay. So we come in with one scenario, and we start to say, things are starting. So things won't be similar everywhere. So we start to say, our model is projecting some changes in the South Atlantic, some changes, smaller changes in the Arctic, but some things are projected to increase under a scenario of climate with no fish. The other model, the IBM, because it was, you remember that more of a flat line is the less pessimistic overall, projects smaller changes, and in one case, it would be, no, sorry, in some cases, it would bring us from a negative outcome to a positive or a slightly positive no change outcome. So this is giving us the idea that, okay, the environmental data and the values that we put in our models matter, still matter, and they give us different results. And here we haven't changed anything in the model. So we are running the same model with the same conditions. What is this for the groups, for the species groups? I just chosen for groups of the 51. This is the large species, the small species, size and small medium size. And you can see that the trends are a bit different, depends on which ecosystem model we are using, and also the point of the RCP scenario, so optimistic or pessimistic. But overall, we saw larger effects on the EPFL and equal size, as before. We start seeing some things going up, some things going down, probably related to some of that predation-cell interactions and diseases from a predation of habitat. And I'm going to show you this concept of losers and winners applied to the results. So if we look at all the functional groups, then we see there's some real losers of all these. So those would be the ones that would be losing under climate change, and they lose diseases as we go farther in climate change. So they lose RCP 2.6, and they lose more under RCP 8.5, but also they also lose more under one of the two models, so IPFL being, as we identified before, more negative overall in our models. We have definitely some winners under no fishing conditions in the ocean, but there are things that appear overall to do better. Several things, and they do better when we go bad in climate. So that's an interesting thing. That would be the thing. And then there is this winner to lose. So under one Earth system model, so under one of these models that we are consuming, they do good, and under the other one, they do bad. So here, this gives us a real uncertainty. That not only, so now we are not just uncertain on the amount of change, but now we are also uncertain about the direction of change. This is only just getting this data in from this Earth system model. Then there is other types of organisms where they seem to be doing good and bad, and they are not really modified by the amount of climate change in each. Okay, if we zoom in to functional group, and this is just a very just an example, also for large fish biomasses, you can see that the idea tends to give us some results. Negative results more in the northern areas and southern areas, while EPFL produces larger declines in the tropics. This is also the kind of drivers seem to produce different results and how things will change and understand the climate in the different regions, and that has an impact on what we are at the ecosystem level. Now experiment two. We are now going to put climate in it. Okay, what may happen is in an ocean we have it's happening. We have climate, but we also have substantial levels of fishing. But overall the results show that there is this negative effect. Again, we see the larger effects from the IPSL and RCP845 as before. Okay. And we see that in specific condition of this we see some compensation. So probably some compensation is going on in terms of removal from some of the fishes, predators, from some of the small organisms in fish a little bit in the biomass and the fishes. If we look at where this is going to happen, again, we see that there's quite a lot of heterogeneity in our perceptions. We don't see the changes in the north or the south. And if we analyze the data with countries, we see again when there is underfishing, things get worse in the southern sector. So basically, underclimate, the winter fishing, quite a lot of places get really worse. And there is only one place where things are projected to be, okay, not thinking about now, but slightly positive, and then it goes back to the worst fishing. This is an experiment. Okay? So things are, you can see also that fisheries in some places also changes not only the magnitude of things, but also the direction. What happens at the functional group level? Here the same group, a large fish, small fish, large fish. We see that, again, it is fairly more pessimistic, after 3.5 produce the worst result. But we see also some declines of this height of the level, that large fish are large. And this is obviously because of fishing, and our model is picking that up. We also see passive interactions kicking in, for example, under some declines of large reef, small reef, under for specific conditions of climate change, if they are not too extreme, they seem to be able to do a bit better, and this is because of this relief of our predicting direction, but under more pessimistic changes of climate, they decline anyway. So it cannot really find, it cannot really compensate for that impact of climate. And there's also losing our reef. In this case, very interesting, we find that some losers lose more. So the losers are losing and the climate change. Now if we see, they lose more. So they lose more when you go from RCP 2.6 to 8.5 and actually you change the Earth system model. Some winners win less. So climate change is those that may be stable by the climate conditions and the fishing conditions is stabling into bringing down. All the things don't seem to matter that much. They do good and bad, and so they do it because the stability of the model and the traffic interaction. And there's some winners, but those from winners to losers, and those more. This is a very interesting case. For example, the natural floods under a non-fishing ocean with climate change, they would do, they are projected to look okay, but under the circumstances of real fishing on climate, then they do pretty bad. And we have a win-win situation. It's the only one that I've identified, which do good on the climate change and will do even better on the climate change of fishing. These are the small bentopelagic fish that go in the ocean, but there's quite a lot of discussion about the biomass that these are going to strike into the water. Actually, it's really okay. The current and future conditions. Okay, we zoom in again. Where these changes are, you can see that the model are quite different depending on which system model we are using. Ones are projecting the changes more in the north, the other ones again, the PSL projecting the changes more in the south, and so in the tropics and the tropics. Okay. Now that's the slide of results. What I'm going to show you now is it doesn't matter if we put our ecological hypothesis inside, it doesn't matter if we really with native ranges or systems and we change the things around. But here I'm showing you a simulation. This is simulation with the same climate drivers used. This is TRBL 2.0. So the milder possible scenario of climate change that we have in the south. And a consideration of ecosystem depth with often for these actions are private alone. Adding the environmental response functions, adding the CTEM for changes in the metabolic rate, adding the native ranges, or altogether. The resources I have shown you until now, they are everything altogether. So the new model is that. But here, as you can see, is that, well, we go for a big picture if you turn things on and off. And in general, here, we have the two indicators that we were using in the presentation. This is total system biomass or total consumer biomass. And you can see that if you use the original configuration for climate and fisheries, or kitchen, or native ranges, there's small declines. And we will see is the general one. If you only use response functions, there's a small increase. And we have some hypotheses and some explanations going on. So it does matter. What we include in our models, the assumptions that we include inside of the ecological model, does matter. However, at the global level, I would say it doesn't matter that much. The amount of change in the equation for the shift does matter that much. And, which is very interesting, and we still have to look at more, is that this is a similar magnitude of order of changes in results when we include the same ecosystem models. So, for me, this means that the uncertainty of having these different drivers coming in the models is a similar magnitude of changing the ecological hypothesis within our model. I think this is interesting. But it's interesting as we look at it, well, we have also different sources of uncertainty that come from external drivers, but also from our configuration. Does it matter for groups, for functional groups, or for the species? Well, again, it does matter. The direction of change is the same, so we could have a decline for the order of the changes by order of magnitude. We go from -5% in 2050 to 40%. So it really does matter. At the larger magnitudes of change doesn't matter that much, change is small, but at the functional group level does matter. So we really need to work more into these assumptions. Okay? And again, it's interesting to realize that there is a similar magnitude of change to results that we get when we consume the different sets of the Earth system. I know this will be dense, I leave it at this, and I will go to some concluding remarks. So it goes into the baseline we see to further develop global marine ecosystem analysis, considering the species, biodiversity, and global dynamics. We can learn about how we implement ecological hypothesis and also how the external drivers are really affecting our results. And eventually, we would like to contribute to the development of assessment of cumulative effects in the ocean, bringing this system, but other types of changes, or hydrogenic changes, and run or use these models to look at the future scenario of global change. So we're trying to find solutions to see if we can have a room or have a space for mitigation, for instance. And we think that the way to go is really work in collaboration with the other models, so we are very happy and still contributing to this ensemble exercise of FITMATE and other chat. Future development. This is obviously not finished at all, and we are working very hard on this, so I'm just going to mention very briefly, because this modularity of the approach that we have taken, we can either change a lot of things in the model configuration, and we have a lot of ideas of things to do, for example, increase biodiversity resolution with Dan and Nicola and Daniel and see if we can breach with the cedar base and fish base. Habitat forming species are another world that also present different challenges to us, and we want to tackle them. Physiological responses are more of that behavioral evolutionary process and play with different spatial and temporal resolutions. External drivers, which is more of what we are doing in the systemic community, we are now in an exercise trying to understand what's the individual contribution of changing temperature or changing climate production alone and see how our model and our species respond to that. And there's also a lot of work in adding new responses, so we would like to pursue oxygen salinity and ice cover and maybe others, and validation and spatial temporal results from the same that we are also working. So with that, I thank you all. I know